Hello and welcome to my new video. Today I will be talking about enveloped viruses and how to model them. Many pathogenic viruses, like viruses for influenza, AIDS or corona, are often misrepresented as strictly geometric entities. In reality, they are surrounded by flexible envelopes derived from their hosts. How can we model such random potato-like structures? The potato-like shape is not very difficult, and I already published a video about this. You can simply use a blob produced from a number of spheres distributed in a random spherical way. There are several approaches for obtaining such a random spherical distribution. Random distributions along latitudes and longitudes will result in an uneven distribution with high densities near the poles. In many cases, this doesn't really hurt. For avoiding this uneven distribution, one can distribute element randomly over a cylinder and subsequently project them onto a sphere inscribed to this cylinder. Have a look at my PoFray scripts to this video on GitHub in case you want to see an example. Once you have your spheres distributed in a sphere-like way, you simply increase their radius and put them together into a blob. Here is your potato, or better, your enveloped virus. Only thing missing are its membrane proteins. They have to stick to the shape and they have to be perpendicular to it. How do we model this? I propose two steps. First, we surround the viral particle with a shell of randomly and evenly distributed points, produced just as described above, and then we use PoFray's trace function. This trace function needs three different things: the position vector of one of the points just produced, an empty vector where PoFray can store the normal vector, and a vector pointing from the point in question towards the center of the viral envelope. Since the center is more or less identical with the origin, we can simply take the negative position vector for this third task. These three vectors, the position vector, the negative position vector, and a predefined empty vector for the normal, are sufficient for trace to work. The function will give you two things as output: the precise location where the negative location vector is hitting the envelope, and the normal vector of the envelope at this place. These two vectors are all we need. We will use the normal vector for rotating our protein until its axis corresponds to the normal vector. This step is not trivial, and I will talk about it below. In the second step, we then transfer our protein to the position where the negative position vector had hit the viral envelope. How do we rotate our protein into a parallel alignment to the normal vector? First, let's assume that the axis of our protein corresponds to the y-axis of the coordinate system. For aligning this axis with the normal vector, we have to do two rotations, first around the z-axis, then around the y-axis. The angles for these rotations can be calculated from the normal vector's coordinates as follows. The angle for the rotation around the z-axis is calculated from the arcsinus of the normal vector's x-coordinate. The angle for the rotation around the y-axis is calculated from the arctangent of the ratio of the normal vector's x and z-coordinate. In the case of negative values for the z-coordinate, 90 degrees have to be subtracted from this result. In the case of positive values, 90 degrees have to be added. Z-coordinates of 0 should be excluded, since they will result in division by 0. After having aligned the protein with the normal vector, you transfer it to its position in the viral envelope and proceed to the next point until all proteins have been correctly positioned. Quest solved. That's all for today. What's next? So far, I have shown you several examples where objects determine position or orientation of other objects. Next time, I will speak about objects influencing each other's shape. As an example, we will learn how to model a simple plant cell tissue. So stay tuned.